Muhammad wa ali Muhammad salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajil.
Al-Fatiha. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على سيدنا ونبينا وشفيع نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا الذي سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأرض بأبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين المنتخبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد وهو أصدق القائلين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنما أنت منذر ولكل قوم هاد صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوا على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
If I can request everybody to come forward a little bit because we have many brothers coming in.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
My dear elders, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
From the dawn of time, the human race had and continues to have needs and desires which need to be fulfilled in order for us to survive and grow. Needs such as quenching our thirst, satisfying our hunger, access to healthcare when we become sick, clothing ourselves. But the greatest and most important of these needs is the need for guidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in chapter 92, verse number 12 of the Holy Qur'an, Surah Al-Layl, He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Inna alayna lal-huda. Indeed, incumbent upon us is guidance. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is saying that guidance of mankind is a task which is the divine duty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. So the question that arises here, and the question we will try to begin to tackle in this lecture, is we have established that our guidance, the human beings, is indeed the duty of and is incumbent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what is the essentiality for this guidance to be in the form of an imam? This imam, must he be divinely selected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or can this imam be appointed by the people? Is it essential for this imam to be alive currently? Or does the Qur'an and the sunnah of Rasulullah suffice as guidance for us, as is the belief of many of our brothers in faith? Firstly, in order to avoid any confusion, let's make our stance very clear on this matter by drawing an early conclusion. Before we present our proofs from the Qur'an and the books of Hadith. When it comes to imamate in Islam, what is the view of our scholars and maraji? All of our Shia scholars are unanimous on the fact that it is essential for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, both from the viewpoint of logic and reasoning, and from what we see in the Qur'an and the books of the Ahadith, that there must be a divinely appointed imam and a hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of this earth at all times, from before the time of the first human being till the very last human being, there cannot exist even a single second where there isn't a hujjat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the face of this earth. Now let's take a look in the Quran and let's see where we can find evidence of these claims. Surah Al-Ra'd, chapter 13, verse number 7 of the Holy Quran. The verse that we recited at the start of this lecture, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُنْذِرٌ وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. Verily, O Prophet of Allah, you are but a warner for the people. And for every nation, we have appointed a guide. Throughout this entire lecture, brothers and sisters, we must keep in mind that the Qur'an is not just for the people of the time of Rasulullah. The Qur'an is universal, and the Qur'an is eternal for all ages, all people, and all times. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives a promise that amongst every single nation, there will be a guide. Then from the time of Adam alayhi salam till the day of Qiyamah, every single nation and every single person on the face of this planet will have a divinely appointed hujjah, a divinely appointed guide. Abu al-Qasim al-Haskani, in his book Shawahid al-Tanzil, has narrated that one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam,
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Rasulullah had called for somebody to bring him some water so that he could make wudu. So as soon as the call went out, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam brings the Prophet of Allah the water. When Rasulullah had completed his wudu, he took the hand of Imam Ali alayhi salam and he placed it on his own chest. And he says, Ana al-Mundhir, I am the warner. Then he places his own hand on the chest of Imam Ali and says, وَأَنْتَ يَا عَلِي الْهَادِ, and you, O Ali, are the guide for the people. وَبِكَ يَهْتَدِي الْمُهْتَدُونَ مِنْ بَعْدِي, and it was only through you, O Ali, that the people will be guided after me. O Ali, you are the light to the people, and you are the sign of guidance, and you are the king of the reciters of the Holy Qur'an, and I bear witness that you are so.
Masha'a.
Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salam is quoted in Basair al-Darajat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
In authentic narrations, he quotes in the translation of this verse. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says mundhir, there is no other than Rasulullah who is the mundhir. And after him, the haad, the guide, will be from us, the Ahlul Bayt. Every period of time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place an imam from the Ahlul Bayt to be the guide for the people. A guide that guides the people to those things which the Prophet had pulled from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, after the Prophet, the first Hadi will be Amir al-Mu'mineen. And after him, the holy imams, one after one, will be guiding the people until the day of Qiyamah. And this translation is quoted in countless books and narrations, in both Shia and Sunni books. We find this necessity for a haad, a guide, a messenger directly appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, let's take a look at another verse of the Holy Quran. Surah Al-Qasas, chapter 28, verse 51 of the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ وَصَّلْنَا لَهُمُ الْقَوْلَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. Indeed, we have sent them our word, one verse after another, one story after another, and the promise and the warning through stories which may provide lessons to them so that they may be mindful. Here the tafsir of this ayat from the Ahlul Bayt is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is saying, indeed we have appointed the imams of the Ahlul Bayt one after the other, and through them we have applied the word, the statement of the truth, and the propagation of the truthful commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the people. This has been narrated by Ali ibn Ibrahim in his commentary. And Shaykh Tusi has also narrated this in many of his lectures with many strong and authentic chains. Another place in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 30 of the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to his angels, O angels of Allah, I am placing upon this earth a caliph of mine. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making an eternal promise. Remember, the Quran, the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is eternal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to the mu'mineen for the rest of the time. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes this promise to the angels of Allah, not only is it for the people at the time of Adam, but till the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, I will place a caliph of mine in this world. There will be no period of time which will pass without an imam of the Ahlul Bayt. In Basair al-Darajat, there is a narration from Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. in the narration of the in the explanation of the Almighty's verse, وَمِمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا أُمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِالْحَقِّ وَبِهِ يَعْدِلُونَ. And amongst whom we have created are a batch of individuals. These batch of individuals, they guide people with truth and they command them with justice. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam says, verily, we are this batch of people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed on this earth to guide people towards the truth and install and command justice amongst them. Ibn Babaway has in his books Majalis and Kamaluddin quoted Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salatu wa salam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Imam Zain al-Abidin says, we the Ahlul Bayt are the leaders of the Muslims and the evidences and the proofs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the world. We are the Sadat and we are the Mu'minun and we are the bright faces of the paradise and the chiefs of those who will have white hands and feet, whose faces and hands will be shining from the radiance of doing wudu. And we are the masters and chiefs of the Muslims. And we are the means of protection from the residents of the earth, from the divine chastisement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just as the stars are the shelters for the residents of the skies. It means so that so long as we are on the earth, qiyamah will not occur. And the punishment will not rain on the people. And so long as the stars are in the sky, the angels need not to fear the occurrence of Qiyamah. Imam continues and he says, we are the shelter. Because of our blessing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects the skies from falling on the earth. But at the time of Qiyamah, by his command alone, the skies will also be destroyed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps the earth safe only and only because of our blessing. And he keeps the earth from tumbling and falling along with its residents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends rain because of our blessings and expands his vast mercy because of our blessings. Allah showers his bounties on the earth due to us. And if none of us were on this earth, if the Ahlul Bayt were not on this earth, the earth would undoubtedly would go underground along with its residents. And this profound statement of the Imam can also be proved from the Holy Qur'an. Chapter number 8, verse number 33 of the Holy Qur'an. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ. O Prophet of Allah, verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot send his chastisement, his punishment down upon the people whilst amongst them are Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Ibn Babaway has narrated authentically from Jabir that Jabir once asked Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salam, O Imam, why is it that the people need a prophet and an Imam? Imam replies to him, so that the world may continue on the right path. Because the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps the chastisement away from the people. So long as there is a prophet or an Imam amongst them. Then he quoted the above verse, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ. This position of Muhammad and Al Muhammad, this level of love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for Muhammad and Al Muhammad, so much so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed the obedience of Muhammad and Al Muhammad on par with the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul wa ulul amri. Obey Allah and obey His Messenger. And obey those ulul amr, those people of authority amongst you. But it is not all people of authority amongst you. Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam says, indeed, we the Ahlul Bayt are the ulul amr. So now we have proved the need for an imam from the Quran, using several verses of the Quran. And indeed, there are many, many, many more verses of the Quran which prove the need for an imam. But how can we prove the need for a divinely appointed guide using our rationale and reasoning? It is narrated that one day Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam,
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad,
once asked Hisham bin Salim, who was one of the scholars from the companions of Imam alayhi salam, O Hisham, narrate to me your encounter with Amr bin Ubaid al-Basri, who was a Sunni Sufi scholar at the time. At the time, Amr bin Ubaid al-Basri was making outlandish claims about himself and was speaking foolishly and heedlessly about Islam. So Hisham replies to Imam, Ibn Rasulullah, I feel ashamed in narrating this encounter to your honor, because it is not worthy of your honor, and my tongue cannot muster the strength to narrate this incident to you, because it is below you, O Imam. Imam insists on him. And in the end, Imam tells him, Oh Hisham, I command you, narrate this story to me. Yeah, I'm not asking you anymore. I command you, narrate this story to me. Hisham said, very well. When I knew about the claim of Amr's grace, and his sitting in the mosque of Basra, and of his talking nonsense in the matter of Islam, it pained me very much. It caused me pain. This is Hisham narrating. So he says, I went to Basra on a Friday, and I attended the mosque where this Amr was sitting. And in the midst of a very big circle of people, he had wrapped a black cloth around his waist and covered himself with a black sheet. And people were asking him questions. So Hisham goes, I also advanced towards him. And I sat on my knees in the last row of the circle of people. Then I raised myself and I said, O scholar, I am an outsider and I have come with a question if you will allow me to ask you. So Amr says to Hisham, he goes, go ahead, Husayn, ask me, what's your question? So Hisham asks him, oh scholar, do you have eyes? So Amr becomes angry, he becomes frustrated. He says, oh boy, what kind of a question is this, do I have eyes? So I say to him, look, oh scholar, such is my question. Either you answer me or you don't answer me. So Amr goes to him, okay, fine, ask me. Even though it is foolish of you to ask me such a stupid question, it's okay, ask me. So I repeated, Hisham says, oh Amr, do you have eyes? He said, yes. So I asked him, what do you do with these eyes? He says, through these eyes I see the colors, and through these eyes I see the faces of people. So then I asked, do you have a nose, oh Amr? He replied, yes. I asked, what do you do with this nose of yours? Lad, I smell fragrances when I walk around, and with this nose I can smell what's happening around me. Then I asked, do you have a mouth? He said, yes. I asked, what do you do with it? He said, I can taste things. I asked, do you have a tongue? He said, yes. I asked, what do you do with it? He said, I talk with it. I asked, do you have ears? He said, yes. I said, what do you do with them? He said, I hear things. I said, do you have hands? He said, yes. I asked, what do you do with them? He said, I can hold things with them. I asked, you also have a heart? He said, yes. I asked, what is the use of this heart of yours? He replied, with my heart, I remove any doubts from any of my other organs. I asked, are your organs, all of your other organs, are they not sufficient on their own, such they must refer the matters to the heart? He replied, no. So I asked him, why? Are they not needless of the heart when all of them are hale and healthy? He said, oh boy, whatever these limbs fall short in, whenever they have any doubt about anything touched or seen or smelt or heard, they refer it back to the heart, and the heart decides the matter. It removes any doubt, and it creates certainty. So then I asked him, oh Amr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has placed the heart in your body, so that it may remove the doubts from your limbs. Yeah? He said, yes. So then I asked him, if it is so, then the heart must always be in your body, else if it is not there, then the knowledge of your organs is not firm, and your other organs are rendered useless. So he said, yes, of course. So then I said, oh Abu Marwan, do you believe that the Lord of the universe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has not left your bodily organs without a leader and a chief, so that they may find the truth during unsettling times, and so that they can clear any doubts that arise within them, in your sight, in your smell, in your touch, in your hearing, all of these doubts are eradicated by the heart. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has not left your hands, your ears, your nose, your mouth without a heart, you believe that he has left the entire creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with doubts. He has left his entire creation with differences and bewilderments, and did not appoint any leader for them, and did not appoint an imam for them, so that they may turn to him and ask him questions when they become in doubt, so that he can lead them to the right path. When I said this, he kept quiet and he did not give a reply. Subhanallah. Look at the logic and the thinking of the companions of the imams. In the books, Talqis by Shaykh Tusi and Shafi of Sayyid Murtada, may Allah have mercy on them, we find a profound logical argument which proves the essentiality of an imam who is divinely chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and has complete knowledge of the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The argument is, it is necessary that there should be a protector of the sharia of the messenger of Allah, who may protect it from deviation, from change, from any additions or deletions. And since the verses of the Qur'an are comprehensive, even the atheists, sometimes they use the Qur'an to prove their points. So therefore the Qur'an is comprehensive, it is subject to interpretation. So without a divine leader, without somebody who can tell us, when the Qur'an tells us we must pray Fajr. But the Qur'an does not tell us how many rak'at Fajr is, or how we should pray Fajr. So without a leader who can tell us how many rak'ats are in Fajr, and how we should pray our Fajr, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not be a just Lord, would not be a kind, a merciful Lord. And lutf is wajib upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is obligatory upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, famously, at the time of his demise, when he called for a pen and paper, so that he may write down something for the ummah so that they do not go astray. And Rasulullah begins to narrate the hadith of Thaqalayn, which we all know very well. Yeah? I'm leaving with you two weighty things. Yeah, the Qur'an and my Ahlul Bayt. So when Umar heard this, he said, this man, this messenger of yours, he does not know what he is saying. He's talking senselessly. Yeah? This book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this Qur'an that he has left us with, is sufficient for us. It is enough. Even despite the fact that Umar did not even know the explanation of a single verse of the Qur'an. Any time there would be controversy between the people, Umar and his companions, who would they go to? Yeah? They would go to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. So much so that the Ahlul Sunnah have written that on 70 different occasions, not one, not two, on 70 different occasions, Umar would say, Lawla Ali la halaka Umar. Had there not been Ali, Umar would have been destroyed. There would have been no Umar. Had the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala been enough, then surely, if there was no need for an imam, then surely Umar, the caliph of the people, should have been able to solve the controversies that had arose without the help of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Kulayli and Ibn Babawayh have authentically narrated from Imam Baqir alayhi salam that he said, if the imam separates himself from the earth, even for a single moment, the earth, along with all of its inhabitants, would begin to waver, just like the sea would waver in a storm. It is also narrated from Imam al-Ridha that he said, we are the hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on his earth, and we are the trustees of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With his permission, we are the caliphs of Allah amongst his servants. We are the word of righteousness, the kalimatul taqwa. And we are the urwatul wufqa, as mentioned in the Holy Quran. وَأَلْزَمَهُمْ كَلِمَةَ التَّقْوَى. And we have made incumbent upon them the word of righteousness. Or in the words of Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we have made incumbent upon them the wilayat of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. By Allah, from even before the creation of Adam alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had already created his hujjah. We have all heard the narration of the Holy Prophet of Islam, where he says, أَوَّلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورِي. The first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had created, the first creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was the nur, was the light of Muhammad and al-Muhammad. And until the last moment, until the day of judgment, there will be a hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our traditions tell us that even if there were two human beings left, one was the hujjah of Allah, and one was non-hujjah, then by Allah, the last person to die on the face of this earth would be the hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that tomorrow, on the day of judgment, not a single soul can stand up and say, oh Allah, when I was on this earth, you did not place a hujjah for me. There was no leader for me. But what is it that separates a divinely appointed leader from any normal leader or prime minister or president that we have today. One day, Imam Ali alayhi salatu wa salam, so one day Imam Ali was the governor and the caliph at the time, was walking through the bazaar. While he was walking in the bazaar, he sees a woman, a widowed woman. And she was walking and carrying these heavy bags. And while he was walking, she had two orphans with her who she was taking along her side. So Imam alayhi salam, of course, he had a soft spot for orphans. He did not have an entourage of bodyguards like we see today. If you were to look at him in the markets, and you did not know who Ali ibn Abi Talib was, you would not know him. He would look like an average individual. You know, when we look at leaders today, what do we see? 60 cars, bodyguards, yeah, and it's not even the prime minister, it's a public health minister or something like that. All of these bodyguards and all of this for what? Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, the caliph of an empire that covers over 50 countries of today. He sees a widow and he goes to offer her help. When he offers her help, she thanks him. And she says, may Allah bless you. Yeah, may Allah reward you. And then she says something strange. She says, may Allah never forgive Ali ibn Abi Talib. So if this was me and you, if we were in Imam Ali's shoes, what would we do? Yeah, we'd say, hey, what are you doing? What are you saying? I'm Ali ibn Abi Talib. Yeah, how dare you say something like that to me? Imam Ali says, stay silent. And he doesn't tell her who he is. But he asks, oh woman, why is it that you curse or you're making dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never forgive this man Ali ibn Abi Talib? She says, oh man, my husband, he went to war with Ali ibn Abi Talib and he was killed in the battle. And now look at what happened. My orphans are now left without a father. My life is a mess. And then this is all the fault of Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Imam alayhi salam, when he heard that, it broke his heart. So Imam walks with her and he says, you know what, let me get you some more food. So he goes, he buys her some more food. And he says to her, look, oh woman, would you like me to cook for you this food that I have bought you? Or would you like me to offer you some help? Yeah, either I will cook for you or I can look after these two orphans of yours. I can play with them. So she says to him, listen, oh man, I will do the cooking because I'm probably better at the cooking than you are. And you just look after the children and keep them entertained. So Amir al-Mu'mineen, he goes down on his knees and he begins to play with these two orphans. Have you ever seen any warrior like this? Any president, any prime minister, any leader of the world sit on his two knees and play with orphans like he is this widow's servant? Amir al-Mu'mineen, the king of kings, plays with these two children as if he is this woman's slave. The woman's neighbor comes into the house. And the woman's neighbor, she was aware who Ali ibn Abi Talib was. She knew who he was. So when she walks in and she sees Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam playing with these two orphans of the woman, she says, oh woman, what are you doing? Do you know who this man is? She says, no, who is this man? She tells her, this is Ali ibn Abi Talib, the caliph, the commander of the faithful. He's babysitting your children. What are you doing, oh woman? What is the matter with you? The woman didn't know what to say. Then at that moment, she had realized that this is Ali ibn Abi Talib. And she had remembered how at the start in the market, when he helped her, she had cursed him. She said, may Allah not forgive Ali ibn Abi Talib. So she says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, please forgive me. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to say this. You know, I was just saddened. So what does Imam tell them? He says, no. Oh woman, I am sorry. I, Ali ibn Abi Talib, I'm sorry. That this is all I can do for you. Look at the humility and the humbleness of Imam Ali alayhi salam. This is the same man who killed Amr bin Abdiwad. This is the same man who is Asadullah al-Ghalib. Yet he is here helping a widowed woman, looking after and babysitting her children. He was courageous. But at the same time, he was the king and he was at the peak of humility and humbleness. So the question is, how can we show our loyalty and devotion and obedience to these divine imams of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Let's have a look at the companions of Aba Abdullah and how they displayed their unwavering loyalty to the imam of their time. In the camp of Imam Husayn alayhi salam on the night of Ashura, it is said that Imam gathers all of his companions in his tent, and he says to him, and he says to them, "Oh my loyal companions, these enemies of Allah, they are not after you, they are only after me. They are after my blood. They want to kill me. They have no business with you. Why don't you take the darkness of this night as your cover? And each and every one of you take the hand of one of my Ahlulbayt and go and save your lives. Go back to Medina. By Allah, I relieve you of the covenant that I have over you. By Allah, I bear witness that on the day of judgment you have been loyal. By Allah, I will ask my grandfather Rasulullah for your shafa'at on the day of judgment. But oh my companions, go, save your lives, I am releasing you." Then Imam looks around and he sees no one is moving. So he says to them, "Okay, I think you might be embarrassed." So Imam says to Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, "Oh Abbas, turn off the candle." Abbas turns off the candle. After a long time, Imam with his own two hands, he goes to turn the candle back on. The narrations say, when he turns the candle back on, he sees, he has a look around, and he sees not one single person has moved from their seat. Imam then looks at them, and he says, "Oh Abbas, why did you not go?" Abbas says to him, "Oh Mawla Hussein, do not burden me with this question." He looks at the sons of Aqil, and he says, "Oh sons of Aqil, you have already given Muslim bin Aqil. You do not have to give any more." They say, "Oh Mawla Hussein, what face will we show our people in Medina when we have left our Mawla and our Aqa alone amongst the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt?" Imam looks at Zuhayr. He says, "Oh Zuhayr, why do you not go? Oh Budayr, why do you not go? Oh Habib, why do you not go?" One after the other they stood up. One of them stood up and he says, "Oh Mawla Hussein, I wish that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given me 1,000 lives, and in every life I get the opportunity to sacrifice that life in your love. I wish that I get cut into pieces, and that my body is burnt, and the ashes are scattered, and Allah brings me back to life 1,000 times, and each time I will choose your path." Imam comforts them and congratulates them. Then Imam alayhi salam is guarding the tent. Lady Zainab calls her brother Hussein. She says, "Oh Hussein, have you tested the loyalty of these companions of yours?" She says, "These are the same people who were treacherous towards our father Ali. It was these same Kufans who were treacherous to our brother Hassan." Imam says, "Oh Zainab, don't worry, I have tested them." One of the companions of Aba Abdullah, he overhears this encounter with Sayyida Zainab, and he immediately rushes towards the tents of the companions. He reaches to the tents. He says, "Oh Habib, you are here reading the Quran while Lady Zainab is questioning your loyalty." Habib throws his amama on the ground. He calls on to his companions. He says, "Unsheath your swords and come and follow me." They all followed Habib. When Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas saw this, he said, "Oh Uncle Habib, where are you going?" Habib says, "Oh Abu al-Fadl, stay out of this." They go in front of the tent of Bibi Zainab. They line up in front of the tent. They place their swords on their necks. And they say, "Assalamu alaykum ya ahla bayt al-Nubuwah." Salams unto you, O great household of the Prophet. By Allah, these companions have sworn an oath that if you order us right now, we will take our own lives. Imam Husayn alayhi salam says to his sister, "Oh Zainab, now go and comfort them." Sayyida Zainab raises her hands. She makes a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to strengthen them and to bring strength into the hearts of the companions of Aba Abdullah. But the day of Ashura had arrived. Habib goes and he didn't come back. Budayr goes and he doesn't come back. Zuhayd goes, Qasim goes, Ali Akbar goes, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas goes. Now when no one has remained, Imam Husayn alayhi salam goes into the battlefield and he lets out a cry. Hal min nasirin yansurna, hal min dhabin yadhubu an haram rasulillah. Is there anyone who is willing to come and help me? When he was shouting with the loudest of his voice, he heard the cries and the shouting from the ladies of the tents. He returns back to the tents. He says, oh, my sister Zainab, why is it that you cry when I am still alive? She says, oh, my Mawla Hussein, each time you would call out, Allah hal min nasirin yansurna, little Ali Asghar would throw himself off his cradle, almost as if he was saying to his father, oh, Father Hussein, there is still one more soldier in your camp. Allah la'natullahi ala al-qawm al-zalimin, wa sayalamu al-ladhina zalamu ala Muhammadin, ayyamun qalabin yanqalibun.